is an electrochemical reaction. It's also called as an electrochemical double layer or electric double layer. Okay, and these kind of capacitors we typically call as an electric double layer capacitors. And now you can understand, you know, instead of having just a flat metal plate, if I have a material electrode which is highly porous in nature, right, then this absorbed charges will be more on the porous electrode. Why? Because considering this as the pore, one of these small tiny pores, right, this on every surface of the pores, this negative ions can get absorbed. Negative ions from the electrolyte can get absorbed. Correct? Whereas instead, if I just have a plain sheet, like a gold plate, you know, you can actually literally count the number of ions which is absorbed. Basically, it is just equivalent to the flat surface, right? Instead, if I have a highly porous, every pore is basically impregnated or wet with this electrolyte, and every surface of the pore is basically absorbed, will have an absorption of these anions, correct? So, more charges getting absorbed onto my surface, the more larger will be the double layer, and larger will be the capacity. Understand? So that's why you have to have, and that's exactly why this area terms come here, isn't it? More the area of the electrode, more the capacitor, double layer capacitor. I don't know if you've noticed this D factor here, right? What does D factor stand for? D factor is the distance between the two parallel charges, distance between the positive as well as the negative charges in a typical double layer capacitor. So here, what do you think is the typical D? D is nothing but, you look at carefully, this green and this positive sign. What is the distance between the two charge carriers? Correct? This green is nothing but the ions. Okay? It is an ion. Typically, the radius of the ion will be of the order of something like Armstrong, 10 to the power of minus 10 meter. Right? So, half that would be the distance between the two. So, typically, what I'm trying to say is, like in this expression for capacitance, the denominator D will be very, very small, of the order of like 10 raised to minus 9 or 10 raised to minus 10 meter, which makes the capacitance huge. Think about it, right? The capacitance will be very, very high. And that's one reason why these are called as super capacitors or ultra capacitors, right? So these are very similar to the double layer capacitor, sorry, the dielectric capacitor. But we have seen the difference. And another main difference we get to see is that the obtained capacitance will be, you know, of the order of farads, right? Will be very high compared to the normal dielectric capacitor that we are aware of or familiar with. I hope that point is clear. That is the very basic fundamental regarding the supercapacitor. Now, how do you calculate the effective capacitance of a supercapacitor? Let's say I have two electrodes, and that is why I make a full cell supercapacitor. What happens? At each of these electrodes, there is one capacitance formed. Why? Because there is one double layer here, there is another double layer here. Whenever there is a double layer formed, of course, I can say that there is a capacitance C1 here. Why? Because these are parallel plate charges, parallel layer of charges separated by a distance, right? So that basically forms this capacitance here. I think that part is clear, right? Epsilon A by D, right? Now, moving on, there will be another capacitance here, C2, right? So that basically makes, you know, two capacitors, right, in series. So the effective capacitance of this device would be, you know, 1 over C1 plus 1 over C2. Isn't it? This is the effective capacitance that you're taking, you're talking, you get out of the device, right?